going way back from the beginning, when I was about 5 years old, after the First World War, my father originally in Italy was a trumpet player, carpenter. And after he, you know, he came to the States around 1916, around there. And he, as soon as he got here, he got drafted and got sent back to France. Then when he came back to New Britain, Connecticut, we were born, I was born in New Britain. You know, my whole family was born in New Britain. And they had this Italian American World War Veterans Society. It was a club, you know. And my father, they had a drum corps, drum and bugle corps. And my father lost his teeth, you know, had false teeth, so couldn't play trumpet anymore. So they needed a snare drum player in the Italian symphonic band, not the drum corps, in the Italian symphonic band. So, you know, because he could read and all that, he took up the snare drum. And then eventually, you know, it led to him teaching young guys in the drum and bugle corps. So he used to take me with him. I had two brothers, Dominic and Samuel. And they both played later on. You know, they both played snare drum. They, me and my, eventually, me and my two brothers both played in the drum corps, drum and bugle corps there in New Britain. But, you know, when I was about five, my father kind of like took to me. You know, I was like, of the three boys, for some reason, he always took me where he went, you know. So he used to take me to the rehearsals at the drum and bugle corps. And I just, you know, sat there and watched them, and, you know, kind of sunk into me, you know. What they called, for drummers, there were two beats, drum beats, that drummers use in a drum and bugle corps. And it's what they call 2-4, 1-2-3-4. I mean, you know, 1-2-1-2. And the other was like a 6-8 rhythm, which is very similar to the Italian tarantella. 1-2-3-4-5-6, 1-2-3-4-5-6. So it was like in two, but they both, one had a up and down duple feel and the other had a triplet feel. And so I picked up on it. You know, I'm watching him teach. You know, of course, he was teaching them how to do the open roll. In drum corps, you use the open roll. One day, my father had a friend, Frank Skinner, and there was a bar in our neighborhood they used to hang out at. And Saturday night, this Frank Skinner used to play there with a, you know, accordion player and whatever. And he used to leave his drums at our house after the gig. And, you know, my dad would pack, put them under the bed. And one day, I would, you know, at that time, I was kind of sick with asthma a lot. And I was, you know, father went to work on this and that. And I'm, you know, by now I'm about 6 years old, you know, and I unpacked his drums and I just, you know, set up the snare drum and the bass drum with a foot pedal, and I started playing these cadences, drum beats that my father was teaching. And, you know, I watched him how to hold the sticks and all that. He never literally gave me a lesson. I just did this just watching him. And, you know, I got to be about 7 or 8, and when I went to a drum corps rehearsal, he says, here, gave me a field drum. He says, come on, play. You know the beats. I heard you playing, you know. Just, here we go. So I started playing. And before you know it, my other brother, Dom, picked it up. My brother, Sam, played bass drum, you know. And all three of us were playing in the drum corps. And I remember, like, you know, of course, the only time we played was Memorial Day, you know, was the main day, you know, we performed. And, you know, until I was about 10, I played in the drum corps. I had no inkling of the whole drum set, playing dance music or anything like that. I just played military beats. And then, as that went along, I used to go with my father up in Hartford, Connecticut, which is where we eventually moved to. My father played in an Italian symphonic band up in Hartford. So, not my two brothers, but he would take me along with him up to Hartford. And I would keep him company. You know, we'd take a bus from New Britain up to Hartford. And he played, somehow they heard about him. You know, they needed a field drum player. These Italian symphonic bands, they perform for Italian feast during the summertime. You know, they march in the street. It's very slow marching, but, people from the church, the men carry a saint, she has a dress on and ribbons, and people donate dollar bills, $2 bills, for at night, for auctioning, people donate a pack of, a sack of rice, a sack of potatoes, whatever, And eventually, I used to, of course, I'm sitting there at rehearsals, watching my father perform, and I met a clarinet player that was in a band, a young clarinet player, and we got talking about music and how to read, and he kind of explained it to me so that I could understand it. So kind of between him and I, and watching my father, play the music and read, because my father could read pretty well, I started to pick up on it. And before you know it, my father says, come on, join me. And I started playing with him with the Italian band. And eventually, when I was about 10, we moved to Hartford, Connecticut. And I became a member of the band. I was about 10, 11 years old, marching with my father with the Italian band. And I played with them for a few years. And anyways, I got to be about 12, 13 years old, and we had a state theater where they used to bring in the big bands. You know, they would show a movie, and then big band would come on stage, like Tommy Dorsey, Benny Goodman, famous singers, Frank Sinatra. They had Frank Sinatra at the state theater, people like that. And before that, the stage show came in, the local band at the theater, which was a big band, they had union rule. They had to play like what they call an overture before the show started. So we used to go there after school, matinee on Friday, and catch the shows, the big band shows. And the drummer, of course, I was attracted to the drummer, and after the show, we went back at the stage door, and when he came out, I asked him if he gave drum lessons, and he said he did, and he told me where, CJ Conn Music Store. So I told my father about it, so I started taking drum lessons from him. And, that lasted for a couple of years. And then at this time, I met Emil Richards. We went to the same elementary school, and we both went to the same church, and we went to catechism one day, and we both sang in the choir at church, but we were at catechism one day, and priest Father Toscano, he also played piano. He was a piano player. And he announced that we had these, every Friday, we had CYO, Catholic Youth Organization, we had dances, but we would dance to Victrola, records. And he said he wanted to form a band. And did anybody play an instrument? So me and Emil, we raised our hands, and Emil said, I play xylophone. And I said, I'm a drummer, I play in a drummer. And at that time, I was playing, me and my two brothers, were playing in the St. Anthony Drum and Bugle Corps. And we got involved in that. Well, I told the priest, I says, the only thing is I play drums, but just, you know, snare drum. I don't have a drum set. So he says, well, can you play a drum set? I said, yeah, I think so. You know, I've had a, you know, I told him about my experience playing just cadences, you know. So he says, well, we have to get you a drum set. You know, we can go to use, we don't have a lot of money, the church, but we can go see if we can pick up a used drum set. So I said, well, I already have a snare drum. My dad had a real nice Ludwig metal snare drum, his own. And I said, but we have a bass drum from the drum corps, and we have a field drum that we could, with a long screwdriver, put it between the rods of the field drum and the rods of the bass drum, and that could hold, you know, hold the field drum and use it as a tom-tom. During the summertime, we had this public park, Colts Park, and they used to have big bands playing there. And this one Friday, I went down, and you know, I was about 14, then 15, and Al Gentile's band was playing there, and a great band. And I got so excited when I heard it, because I had to walk to the park. You know, I didn't drive in those days, and I was all by myself. I wasn't with any of my friends. And, you know, when I got to the park and heard this music, you know, I got goose pimples. It sounded so great. And I went down and got, you know, went behind the shell. There's a doorway there, of course, to the stage. And I waited till intermission time, and they opened the door. And but the band was still playing when they opened the door, so I could see the drummer and who he was, you know. So when they broke and they came, you know, they took a break, I cornered him and I says, you know, I introduced myself and, well, you know, what was his name and did he teach? He said he taught at Sid Winnick's Music Store. So I was working on tobacco then in the summertime, so, you know, earning, a little money. And at that time, he said he charged $2 a lesson compared to $75, $100 today. And I started taking lessons from him, you know, and he made so much more sense than the previous teacher I had from the theater, from the state theater. He kind of, between my friend, the clarinet player, and then he kind of made me really understand note values in music and, well, you know, how to really make it all come to together. So, and we took to each other, you know, I started hanging around with him, you know, because I had no rules at my house with my parents. They let me do whatever I wanted in those days. And so I started hanging with him a lot. I used to even babysit for him. But he was a great teacher. And, you know, he'd take me on gigs with him. And, you know, sometimes he would let me sit in. Like, he says, come on, play a tune or two, you know. He'd let me sit in. He was in a big band rehearsal, too, at the music school. He'd let me sit in, on, you know, there also. He was like my guru, you know what I mean? He was just, I owe him everything as far as whatever music talent I had in me, he brought it out of me, you know. You know, he taught at the Julius Hart School of Music, which is part of the University of Hartford. He'd let me come on Saturday. They had a, you know, symphony rehearsal. He'd let me, they didn't have, you know, the school was kind of new then, the percussion department. So when he, after the war, Second World War, he became the percussion professor there. And of course, he, under the GI Bill, he was, you know, going to school also. But eventually, he became a professor at the school. So, you know, on Saturdays, he would let me come and sit in with his percussion section. So I started getting a lot of, you know, symphonic experience too. like I said, on some of his jobs, I went with him. There was a band leader in town, Paul Landeman, and he kind of had the society gigs under control, you know, at the country clubs, places like that. And they were playing at this hotel steady, five nights a week. And, you know, I'd go down and visit him, and he, you know, he was a little bit of a heavy drinker. So he'd like to go to the bar and have me sit in and play with the band. So I started getting some real good experience, and the band leader started taking to my playing, Paul Landeman. So he started hiring me. He got so busy. He and his brother, Morris Landeman, was a violinist, and Paul played trombone. Both brothers started hiring me. So I was, you know, playing two nights a week, sometimes three nights a week. I was starting to make some pretty decent money, you know. So jazz-wise, I had some friends, you know, like anybody, you know, musicians. You get to hear about each other, you know, I went to Hartford High, and I knew some musicians that went to Weaver High, you know, met some African-American musicians, you know, in school. So before you know it, you know, we started having jam sessions. On Saturday, we go to a different bar on Saturday, and it just word of mouth, you know, hey, there's a jam session at the Elks Club this week. There's a jam session at the Carpe Diem. So I used to go to those jam sessions and heard some great, great, you know, jazz drummers. So I started, jazz-wise too, started picking up, and I started getting a reputation, you know, as a jazz player. And then, you know, from that, the Hartford Symphony started, and my teacher, Al Lipak, says, you know, you've been sitting in with the school orchestra, you've been playing a lot of literature, I think you ought to audition for the Hartford Symphony is starting, and I think you're a candidate for the percussion section. You've had quite a bit of experience, and you read very well, and, you know, I trusted them. So I went, and then I auditioned. And the funny part about the audition was that I'm auditioning with the drummer that played at the State Theater, my first teacher. We're both auditioning for the percussion chair in the Hartford Symphony. So he got in and I got in, and he was first percussion, I was second percussion. And then you know, we played for free after a couple of years, and then they started, we were starting to get a salary. You know, it wasn't very much, but we started getting paid. And they re-auditioned everybody because we were now getting paid. And I got the first percussion job, and he retired anyways, you know. So I got the first percussion job with the Hartford Symphony. And, you know, the Hartford Symphony used to play for all the opera performances that came in town. I started doing show work. I started doing Broadway musicals. And that led to, I was playing in a jazz club one night. I was the house drummer, and my buddy Amo Richards came home from California to visit his folks. And we got talking, and he invited me to come to California to visit him. And I didn't think too much about it at the time, but I was doing a Broadway show called Man of La Mancha. I premiered that show with Richard Kiley, great musical. I don't know, after a while I kind of got bored. Yeah. At least for me, I got bored playing the same music 6 days a week. So one afternoon, after a matinee, I says, I think I'm going to take Amo up on his invite. So I went to a phone booth and called Amo, told him I'd like to come out and visit him. And he says, come on. So I talked to my, you know, Aileen about it, my wife, and something I either wanted to go to New York, or Chicago. I never thought about L.A. I thought that was strictly movie people, you know. But it so happened in the history, you know, of music, that rock and roll was just starting to, you know, become a big thing. And the studio musicians were kind of changing over from, hiring legit symphonic music musicians. You know, rock and roll was starting to come on the scene, and the composers were asked to, for movie scoring, the composer were asked to kind of write that kind of music, you know, for movies, you know, with a touch of rock and roll, you know. But anyways, so I came out and visited Amo, and, you know, visited him for a week, and Amo took me all over the place. You know, we'd get up at 8 o'clock in the morning, and I'd be with Amo day and night doing studio work. And I just, you know, observed like a son of a gun, you know, checking the other players out, what the music, you know, called for, what it entailed. And I thought about it, and I said, wow, you know, I played in the Hartford Symphony at that time up until, you know, I was going to leave. I played in the Hartford Symphony for 17 years, so I had a lot of experience. So I felt, okay, it's, you know, I can do this. So I came home and I told Amo I just needed some mallet, you know, stuff that I was a little bit insecure about. I wanted to work on for about a year. And year to the date, we moved to California.